Our programs offer many languages. Please visit suprememastertv.com/schedule.
Nos programas ofrecen plusieurs langues. Veuillez visiter suprememastertv.com/schedule.
Nuestros programas ofrecen varios idiomas. Visiten suprememastertv.com/schedule.
我们的节目提供多种语言，请看 suprememastertv.com/schedule.
Why do we complain of nature? She has shown herself kindly. Life, if you know how to use it, is long. Please continue watching for the sage insights by the Stoic philosopher Seneca.
The hospitable people of Italy like to show their warm-hearted nature with the phrase "Come sta," which translates to "How are you?" in Italian. Shining viewers, I'm Francesca. The spirited Italian residents are delighted to have such caring and compassionate brothers and sisters like you. May heavenly blessings keep uplifting your lives.
Welcome to On the Shortness of Life. Life is long if you know how to use it. An essay by Seneca, Veg Advocate, part 1 of 2 on Words of Wisdom.
Seneca, also known as Seneca the Younger, was a prominent Roman philosopher, orator, statesman, and a tragedian author. He was considered Rome's leading intellectual figure during the mid-first century. Although born in Spain, Seneca spent most of his life in Rome, where he received his education in philosophy and rhetoric. In 50 CE, he took the position of tutor, then 4 years later as advisor, to the 5th Roman Emperor Nero. Seneca's life work was strongly influential for generations to come. His ideas figured in the revival of Stoicism during the Renaissance, when he was referred to as a sage admired and venerated as an oracle of moral, even of Christian edification, a master of literary style and model for dramatic art. Seneca's philosophical works are important, and that they initiated the further development of ancient Stoicism as we know it today. Apart from philosophical writings, his contributions included plays, tragedies, essays, and letters dedicated to moral issues. Today, we will open the pages of the well-known essay by Seneca entitled On the Shortness of Life. Here, the Stoic philosopher elaborates on the nature and the principle of time, its real value in how we as humans handle it in a proper manner as we aim towards more meaningful pursuits. The essay is written to Seneca's father-in-law, Paulinus. On the Shortness of Life, Lucius Seneca. The majority of mortals, Paulinus, complain bitterly of the spitefulness of nature. Because we are born for a brief span of life, because even this space that has been granted to us rushes by so speedily and so swiftly that all, save a very few, find life at an end just when they are getting ready to live. Nor it is merely the common herd and the unthinking crowd that bemoan what is, as men deem it, a universal ill. The same feeling has called forth complaint, also from men who were famous. It is not that we have a short space of time, but that we waste much of it. Life is long enough, and it has been given in sufficiently generous measure to allow the accomplishment of the very greatest things, if the whole of it is well invested. But when it is squandered in luxury and carelessness, when it is devoted to no good end, forced at last by the ultimate necessity, we perceive that it has passed away before we were aware that it was passing. So it is. The life we receive is not short, but we make it so. Nor do we have any lack of it, but are wasteful of it.
Just as great and princely wealth is scattered in a moment,
when it comes into the hands of a bad owner, while wealth, however limited, if it is entrusted to a good guardian, increases by use, so our life is amply long for him who orders it properly.
Why do we complain of nature? She has shown herself kindly. Life, if you know how to use it, is long.
But one man is possessed by greed that is insatiable, another by a toilsome devotion to tasks that are useless. One man is besotted with wine, another is paralyzed by sloth, one man is exhausted by an ambition that always hangs upon the decision of others. Another, driven on by the greed of the trader, is led over all lands and all seas by the hope of gain. Some are tormented by a passion for war, and are always either bent upon inflicting danger upon others, or concerned about their own. Some there are who are worn out by voluntary servitude and a thankless attendance upon the great. Many are kept busy either in the pursuit of other men's fortune or in complaining of their own. Many following no fixed aim, shifting and inconstant and dissatisfied, are plunged by their fickleness into plans that are never new. Some have no fixed principle by which to direct their course, but fate takes them unawares, while they loll and yawn. So surely does it happen, that I cannot doubt the truth of that utterance, which the greatest of poets delivered with all the seeming of an oracle. The part of life we really live is small, for all the rest of existence is not life, but merely time. Vices beset us and surround us on every side, and they do not permit us to rise anew and lift up our eyes for the discernment of truth.
But they keep us down. When once they have overwhelmed us and we are chained to lust,
their victims are never allowed to return to their true selves. If they ever chance to find some release, like the waters of the deep sea, which continue to heave even after the storm is past, they are tossed about, and no rest from their lusts abides. Think you that I am speaking of the wretches whose evils are admitted? Look at those whose prosperity men flock to behold. They are smothered by their blessings. To how many are riches a burden? From how many do eloquence and the daily straining to display their powers draw forth blood? How many are pale from constant pleasures? To how many does the throng of clients that crowd about them leave no freedom? In short, run through the list of all these men, from the lowest to the highest. This man desires an advocate. This one answers the call. That one is on trial. That one defends him. That one gives sentence. No one asserts his claim to himself. Everyone is wasted for the sake of another. Ask about the men whose names are known by heart, and you will see that these are the marks that distinguish them. A cultivates B, and B cultivates C. No one is his own master. And then certain men show the most senseless indignation. They complain of the insolence of their superiors, because they were too busy to see them when they wished an audience.
But can anyone have the hardihood to complain of the pride of another, when he himself has no time to attend to himself? After all, no matter who you are, the great man does sometimes look toward you, even if his face is insolent.
He does sometimes condescend to listen to your words. He permits you to appear at his side, but you never deign to look upon yourself, to give ear to yourself. There is no reason, therefore, to count anyone in debt for such services, seeing that, when you performed them, you had no wish for another's company, but could not endure your own. Though all the brilliant intellects of the ages were to concentrate upon this one theme, never could they adequately express their wonder at this dense darkness of the human mind. Men do not suffer anyone to seize their estates, and they rush to stones and arms if there is even the slightest dispute about the limit of their lands. Yet they allow others to trespass upon their life. Nay, they themselves even lead in those who will eventually possess it. No one is to be found who is willing to distribute his money. Yet among how many does each one of us distribute his life? In guarding their fortune, men are often close-fisted. Yet, when it comes to the matter of wasting time, in the case of the one thing in which it is right to be miserly, they show themselves most prodigal.
And so, I should like to lay hold upon someone from the company of older men and say,
I see that you have reached the farthest limit of human life. You are pressing hard upon your 100th year, or are even beyond it. Come now, recall your life and make a reckoning. Intelligent viewers, we thank you for your kind presence for today's words of wisdom.
Please join us again tomorrow for part 2 of On the Shortness of Life. Life is long if you know how to use it. An essay
by Seneca,
Veg Advocate.
Please stay tuned to Supreme Master Television for more uplifting programming. May your treasured time on earth be your worthy way to the glorious heavens and God's mercy.
Our programs offer many languages. Please visit suprememastertv.com/schedule and suprememastertv.com/WOW.